Hello, I'm Nikhil Sklor, Head of R&D here at RaceResult. And in this video, I would like to do a follow-up on the last video where we were talking about precision and especially accuracy of the timing systems. And I would like to give some explanations of how to achieve the best accuracy from our active transponders. So, as I said in the last video, and I highly recommend to watch that before you watch this one here, accuracy means how close together can two transponders be, and we still know which one was first. And if you want to fine-tune the active system for highest accuracy, there are some things that you need to understand of how the system works. So typically, what you do, you have a road, let's say like this, and then you set up a loop, something like this, and you pass by with your transponder somewhere over the loop. Now, what happens while the transponder is passing over the loop is critical to understand. So the loop generates a field, which if you look at it from the side, may be simplified as something like this. Okay, so this is the field strength that the loop is generating. Okay, so there is, if you do a good job, a homogenic field where the transponder is passing through. And what the transponder tries to do is it tries to find that peak, the point where the signal strength is the highest. Actually, I have to be a little bit more precise. The field does look different if you go for the internal mechanics of the inductive field around two conductors. But for our application here and to understand what's important, it is enough to look at the field like this. So you can assume that the highest signal strength will be in the center between the two loops, and that the setup of the loop and the setting of the power is critical for the shape what the transponder is looking for. So what you can or maybe already anticipate is that if you dial the loop power up and down, what happens is that you actually generate different widths of loop. So let's say you have a very low loop power, maybe your loop pattern only looks like this. This would be maybe, let's say, like 20%. Then this would maybe be 50%. And you could also do something like this, which may be 100%. Now, you typically dial in 100% because you want the transponder to detect very high up. People wearing the transponder at the wrist, running through the finish line like this, you want to capture them. You need a high loop power to do that. Now, the problem is if you take that cross section, what happens is if the transponder passes through the loop field, the stronger the field is, the flatter the curve here at the top is. And that makes it difficult for the transponder to figure out where the center line was. So I'll try to draw this in a little bit different way here. So assume we are the transponder trying to record times. We see over time a signal strength. So let's say we have a time and what we call RSSI, signal strength, and we pass over the loop. Now, what happens is that we get data points. We don't get a line, we get data points, which may look, let's say, something like this. And what the transponder needs to do, it needs to identify the data point with the highest signal strength, because that's the time that is recorded for that passing. Now, what you can imagine is that the flatter this curve is, so let's say we have a higher power and the curve is really, really flat, something like this, the more difficult it gets to figure out which of that three, in this case, points was the point in time with the highest signal strength. Unfortunately, there's also some noise. So these are not points. These are actually, there is some randomness. And this can lead to the transponder picking the wrong point for saving its timestamp for that passing. So what you want is that for the transponder, for optimal accuracy, that the loop looks something like this. So it should be as small as possible, and the peak here should be standing out as much as possible. And what you need to do to achieve this kind of pattern is you need to dial down the power to the lowest possible value, and you need to put the loops as close as possible, and you need to put the transponder as low as possible. That's how you can achieve the highest accuracy. So how do you dial in the power? How do you know what's the lowest possible? So our rule of thumb is, what you should do, you take the height where the transponder will be traveling, maybe at the fork, maybe that would be 30 centimeters high, and you double that. So if you know that the transponder will be mounted in 30 centimeters height, you double that, you take it to 60 centimeters, and that's where you should barely detect. So the rule of thumb to set up your loop is that you dial in a loop power which is giving you a barely detecting transponder at double the height you expect in your application. Obviously, this only works if you have a fixed mounting position on all your different participants. For the width of a loop, you just go to the minimum. You go to 30 centimeters, which is our minimum recommended. Now, there's one more point which is important to understand here, is that the shape of this here also depends on the speed of the transponder. Because down here, actually this line here, this axis is time. So the quicker the transponder moves through the field, the shorter this is. The slower the transponder, the more spread out this is. So if you have a slowly moving transponder, think of a barely moving transponder, basically taking forever to cross the finish line. It gets a lot of points with the same signal strength. Then it's almost impossible for the transponder to determine a accurate timestamp. So what you want is you want to have the transponder in a sweet spot. That's why we have different configurations for the Active Card and the Active Pro, where the sweet spot of the speed of the transponder for highest accuracy is different. So you need to have your transponder moving fast, or at least at a minimum speed to get some accuracy, to have a one point with higher signal strength. But you don't want it to be too fast again, because if you move too fast, you may not have enough points to even detect, but that's not really the problem. Our transponders work over 200 kilometers per hour. It's more about you may not detect the point of higher signal strength anymore. You have one here and one here, but you're missing this one here because you were moving too fast. That's why we indicate a sweet spot for the speed of our transponders. So I know this is kind of complex, and you don't need to understand all of this. And as I said, the shape of the inductive field is actually even more complex if you think about the details. If you go into 3D, with the 3D transponder receiving antenna, it is even more complex than this. But this, if you can keep this in mind, then you already understood a lot. And at the end, what you need to keep in mind is if you want high accuracy, put your loop narrow, put your transponder down, dial down the power to the minimum possible. That's how you achieve highest accuracy. If you're going down to that accuracy, also mounting the transponder will be pretty important. That's why we actually have our transponder holders, where you can generate a situation where the surroundings of the transponders are repeatable. Because at the end, if you're looking for 1/100th of a second accuracy, what's happening directly around the transponder gets important because it will bend this field. So if you have a carbon fiber bike or an aluminum bike, it will make a difference. The shape of your fork of your bike may make a difference. Depending where on the bike it is mounted may make a difference, things like that. So you need to make sure to at least have the transponder mounted at the exact same position on every participant to get comparable results. Yeah, so I hope this makes things a little bit clearer of what's important to achieve highest accuracy and gives you some insights of how the active system actually works. And yeah, see you next time.